the time is now, man. To me, that exhilarates me. That'll bring any added pressure.
After what proved to be the perfect time for a bye week in their schedule, the LC Wildcats would begin preparation for the number 6 team in Division 3, the Wesley College Wolverines, in what will be LC's first home game of 2012, and the chance to put LC football into the national spotlight. That thought will dominate the Sunday meetings.
This game won't make us or break us. You hear me? And that needs to be our approach. This game will not make us a break. Well, I think we approach practice the same way. We ain't gonna make a big deal about who's coming to town. We're just gonna, it's gonna be a business week. Let's get a week better. You know, I think it's kind of one of those places in the program where this can be a marquee kind of deal. And let's just have fun with the process.
Dear gracious and Heavenly Father, I just come again, Lord, just thanking you, Father God, just for getting us back here safely, Lord God. I just pray to be with this team as we go into preparation.
Time to get back to work, get this show on the road. We see them boys ain't invincible. They lost this weekend. But that still don't mean that they're going to come in here and lay down. So let's do what we got to do.
This weekend goes deep. You know, are we ready to play ball for real? You know, they still in the top 5. I don't care if they lost or not. They still top 5, man. So if y'all don't want to win, don't come to practice. Because people that come to practice, we want to win.
And at the end of the day, we're going to be all riled up. It's a home game, night game, but it's going to boil down to the X's and O's. And Reggie said it best, do what you can control, and that's going to be your effort and your assignment. And that's what's going to boil down if we win or lose. The games I've seen us lose, we can go back on film and say we didn't do this or we didn't do that, but it was still in our control. So mine is just do what you can control to your best ability. It's going to boil down to your assignment, each player individually that comes together as this team.
It's another week for us to get better. We know who's coming to town. I mean, they'll talk about it and they'll be publicized. But here's the deal. We're Louisiana College. We know who we are. We know what kind of work we've put in. We know how prepared we are. We know that we don't get bored with doing the little things, and that's how we're gonna approach this week. We're gonna approach this week like we do any week, and that's work on little things and expounding on every little thing. Let's go into this week with character, with communication, and let's have fun. Let's have fun this week.
It's gonna be hard to play harder than them. They're pretty athletic on the front. It's gonna be hard to play faster than them.
And as the players break into their film study groups, they'll quickly realize they're playing a superior level opponent.
They're not as talented, but they're gonna play a lot harder than what we see. So it's up to us, it's up to the end on how we play and how much pressure we put on them. We've talked about this, 6'3", 280, 6'4", 275, true freshmen. Inside, they're about 6 foot, 255, 260. All right, this was their favorite set Saturday. Pro twins, one receiver here, two backside. They'll go gun or under center.
This guy can block, but they also like to get him in the passing game. Sometimes they max protect, but this guy's a pretty good athlete, okay?
They beat the misdirection team.
They're mostly just a zone team from what they've seen so far. They'll throw in some counter and some power. This is the same route our offense runs. The sit with the bender right there. We've seen it, worked to it. We should have a backer right here, jamming. Get good jams, guys. Get good jams. I'm telling you, a guy that throws off this quarterback especially will throw his timing off a whole lot.
Facing one of the biggest games in school history, the LC Wildcats begin their game day Saturday with looseness that portrays confidence and preparedness. Over the cafeteria, the pregame meal, with a team chapel that follows, food for the body and food for the soul.
And so, God, I just pray that you be with these guys and give them the strength to do it, God. And just have fun with you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
outside the LC student body, getting into the spirit of the day as well. Back at the Fieldhouse, White Shirt Pride features two recent graduates of the program, defensive tackle Josh Montgomery, a member of the Wildcats through last year, 2011.
But let me tell you a little bit about White Shirt Pride for those of you who may not completely understand it yet. It's about giving everything you got. It's about lining up beside your brothers and knowing that they're gonna get their job done. Phil, lined up right beside him. Juarez, lined up right beside him. The guys that have my back, Nate, Reggie, Eugene, Lance, it ain't just y'all playing. Y'all playing through us. Let's get it.
While safety Lance Stone played for LC until 2009 and now coaches at nearby Pineville High School.
Tonight, y'all, man, y'all have a rare opportunity. You got the, what, number 16? 16 in the country coming to your home turf. Ain't nobody outside this football office believe you're gonna win. That's how it is. Wesley's a powerhouse, LC's an up-and-comer. You gotta take an opportunity to knock them off. You got a chance nobody else in this program's ever had, and I'd kill to have this opportunity. Walk at that 7 o'clock on the dot knowing you can make history. You can put LC on the map with this win, you can get respect, you get everything this program deserves is in y'all's hands. Because hey, the funny thing about defense, if they don't score, they don't win, right?
Somebody's on our turf right now. They are on our turf. They're coming today, and they're trying to get us. They're looking for you guys, all right? Because it's been in the papers. It's been on our website, White Shirt. We've given up a few yards here and there. Hey, forget it. Let's be the White Death. Let's kill it off right now. They're coming on our turf. Let's snipe them off. We don't got them big weapons. We don't need big weapons. We're our weapons. It's like Coach Dunn said, if we're back to back, if our backs are to each other, all we got to do is stick together, right? Let's go. Get it up. Let's go.
3, 1, 2, 3.
White Dad.
With this being the first home game, the renewal of another game day tradition. It is called the Victory Walk. From the football field house to Wildcat Stadium. Like a march of soldiers onto war, the Wildcats take the walk for the first time in 2012.
It's game day, baby.
No sense of showing up and not showing off, man.
Gotta eat.
Number one, baby.
Hey, hey.
Show out.
I saw the walk though, yeah. Like the Alabama or whoever does those walks like that. It's pretty neat.
Well, it's not by design.
Let's go!
Go, go, tell
shot the nation, baby.
Also back for the Wildcats this game, their senior linebacker, Nate Jansen, the team's leading tackler in 2010 and 11, after missing the first two games due to hernia surgery.
That's probably one of the hardest things you could go through, just being hurt and having to watch all your teammates, the people that you've like grinded with, you know, keep grinding and you can't.
I got a good feeling, real good feeling. Gonna whoop these boys.
Who do you think you are? As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Stay together. Strength and honor. Let's pray. Father God, bless our worship tonight. Lord, we do this as unto you. And Lord, we pray that the will of heaven come to earth tonight, to do a miracle tonight. In Christ's name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
All right, captains can go.
Team, it's your call. What's your call?
Tails or
tails? Called tails. Tails. He called tails. It is heads. You have won the toss.
You want to receive?
You want to receive. Which end do you want to kick? Louisiana College has elected to receive. Get them on the field.
First play, Jeremy, 60 minutes.
After winning the toss, the Wildcats start first on offense. And building on his first 2 weeks' performance, Ryan Montague looks to set the tone early. But that great start quickly turns against the Wildcats when Wesley's Luke McGinnis steps into the passing lane, the interception of Jamie Bunting, and the return to the LC 3-yard line. So now the challenge for the LC defense, and the white shirts rise up. The fumble by Chris Cummings. Jansen emerges from the pile with the ball and an overflow of enthusiasm.
I just had to adjust and, you know, try to work through it and, you know, keep breathing. That's pretty much the only thing I had to do is just, because I felt like I was going to pass out after the first quarter. It was bad, but just glad I stuck through it.
They put our back against the wall on the goal line, and our guys just bowed our necks and said, so what? Bring your best. We brought our best. So I saw a lot of fight in our guys tonight.
The Wildcats backed into their own end zone, but Montague, eluding a first tackle attempt, takes it 17 yards for the first down and some breathing room. Using the play action, this time Bunting passing, and finds Tank Wright in the flat. And with a couple of sensational moves, Wright goes 57 yards to the Wesley 16. But the Wildcat drive stalls, three straight incompletions, and LC settles for the field goal try. The sophomore Adon Oliveras hitting from 31 yards out, Wildcats jumping into the lead 3-0, showing perhaps some offensive maturity in the game's first 5 minutes. Meanwhile, the LC defense keeping the Wolverines shut out for the first 15 minutes. LC leads 3-0 after the first quarter. Early in the second quarter, Wesley finally getting on the board, capping a 7-play, 61-yard drive, quarterback Justin Sotelaire connecting with Steve Caduso for the 8-yard score, the Wolverines taking their first lead 7-3.
We're overflowing too fast, and if you're a cutback player, be a cutback player. Okay. They're not doing anything special.
And on the ensuing kickoff, the Wildcats suffering their second major injury of the season to their receiving core.
Bounce down.
This time it's Tank Wright, hit on the forearm. After the game, the team would learn that Wright has suffered a broken arm and would be lost for the season. Almost on cue, when the Wildcats need a replacement for Wright, another senior who's been waiting in the wings himself, Brian Sampson, the one they call Skinny, answering that call. Sampson had missed all of 2011 due to reconstructive surgery on his knee. His, too, is a story of overcoming and perseverance. Using a variety of plays, the Wildcats putting together a drive that sees them reach the Wesley goal line. And on second and goal, Montague taking it in behind Big Wayne Harris. Wildcats reclaiming the lead 10-7, capping a 15-play, 82-yard drive that took nearly 6 minutes. But it's a lead that won't last long. In contrast to LC's sustained drive, Wesley takes just 3 plays and a minute 14 to go 83 yards, capped by DeVar Robinson's 63-yard run, and the Wolverines back in front 14-10.
Hey, let's go right here.
Following an exchange of possessions, the Wildcats getting their turn again, but only a minute 24 left in the half, and the player who is emerging as Bunting's go-to guy in the slot, Kyle Gallion, the junior out of Denison, Texas, for 20 yards, takes it to the Wesley 28. 2 plays later, same two connecting. Gallion's 29-yard catch giving LC the lead again, 17-14, with 31 seconds left in the half. And for Gallion, double duty, also serving as Oliveras' holder. With just 25 seconds left in the half, Wesley deciding to try to make something happen, but something bad happens instead. Sotelaire picked off by senior Broderick Pop Frederick. Wildcats holding the 17-14 lead. 30 minutes done, 30 minutes left to go.
This game is your game, man. It is your game. They ain't better than you. They ain't better than you. You play your assignment, you play fast, and you make the play. And you make the play when your number's called. Bottom line, how bad do you want it? How bad do you want it, seniors? How bad do you want it, seniors? You got 30 more minutes for the rest of your life, man.
You got them tired right now.
Yeah, that's right.
Listen to me.
All night.
Knock them out. The fourth quarter's going to be ours. You understand me?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Hey, right, baby. Let's go.
Let's pray.
Father God, bless our worship in the second half. Lord, we thank you for strength and honor. We're going to give you the glory in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Hey, baby, zone out, bro. Zone out. Yeah. All you got to do is vibe. Get in yourself. You don't feel these goosebumps? Get in yourself.
Yeah.
Zone out and kill them.
Kill them.
Body bags on three. 1, 2, 3.
Body bags.
Making an appearance at the game, former receiver Darnell Williams, the LC record holder in a number of receiving categories after brilliant campaigns in 2010 and 11. The man having to fill Williams' shoes in 2012 is Cortland Bell, and after a quiet first half, Bell, a threat to take it all the way anytime he gets his hands on the football, takes this one 39 yards to the Wesley 30. From there, Bunting looking for the man who figured to be LC's top receiving threat in 2012, senior DeMario Parker. The ball underthrown and Parker not making much effort to defend. An interception by Leon Jones ending the LC drive.
Bunting pass picked off in the end zone by Wesley College.
A Wesley penalty has them starting at the 6. That's where LC's defense takes over. First, Bill Ford on the tackle for no gain. And after another Wesley penalty, Sotelaire's pass to Caduso going nowhere. Junior Eugene Jackson with the tackle in the end zone. That's a safety. The Wildcats extending their lead to 19-14.
I think they tried thinking they could be tougher than us, and they weren't. They thought they could get the edge on us, and they didn't. I'm just proud of I'm just proud to be their coach.
Let's go, O!
Wildcat defense will again hold, giving the offense the ball once again, and the Wildcats looking to go up by two scores now with a drive that takes them down to the Wesley 11-yard line on the run by sophomore Reggie Sims. But on third and six, bunting nearly fumbling, then tries to run with the ball, tackled well short of the first. The Wildcats having to settle for the field goal, but a problem that will plague the team in key points all season. This one is blocked. Wesley returns it to midfield. The Wolverines bidding to reclaim the lead, but this time it's Sotelaire picked off by sophomore Shaq Lewis. He returns at 47 yards to the Wesley 35.
How many takeaways is that? Four? All day, man.
Hey.
In a close game where a handful of plays can make the difference between winning and losing, perhaps this one will stand out as much as any. Bunting to the end zone for Parker, but it's dropped. The Wildcats settling for the field goal. They lead by 8, 22-14 heading into the fourth quarter. And as the fourth quarter gets underway, another play to add to that what-if list. Showing his uncoverable speed in the post route, Bell poised to make the touchdown grab, slipping through his fingers. The door remains open for a Wesley comeback as the intensity of this game takes a step up.
And it was so much fun to actually go against people that gave you a challenge rather than just rolling over people. I like to play physical. They like to play physical. So, I mean, as far as that aspect, it's an extremely physical game, and, I mean, it was just a blast.
So the pressure's back on the LC defense, and it's Ford showing some amazing speed of pursuit from the backside to make the tackle. Even so, the Wolverines putting together a scoring drive from the LC 33, Sotelaire finding Matt Barlisle, and with 9:18 left in the game, Wesley down by two. And they make the decision to go for that two and get it when Sotelaire connects with Caduso once again. New game, tied at 22. In the drama that has been building following an LC three and out, the Wildcat defense nearly coming up with another huge play, but Lewis dropping what could have been his third interception of the game. As it is, the Wildcats force the punt when junior Dominic Graham stops Sotelaire 1 yard short of the first down. And so with 3:42 left in the game, the Wildcats beginning what they hope will be a game-winning drive. Montague for 7 here. But the drive threatens to stall when on 3rd and 2, Montague getting 1, but it leaves 4th and 1 for LC at the Wesley 46, and decision time for the head coach.
Coach, Lord Peter. Lord Peter.
All right.
You better make it. Let's go.
Behind your boys now.
Hey, you played 4 years for 1 yard. 4 years for 1 yard.
Love it. All right.
And so for a second straight week, the play on which left guard Darren Moore pulls pays off. The first down keeps the LC drive alive at the Wesley 44. And for Montague, another huge night, 132 yards on 32 carries. In the game of football, fortunes can change quickly, as they do here. Bunting's third interception of the game, and the second one for McGinnis. Now it's Wesley with a chance to win it.
What happened on that?
Just cover two of the corner. The corner sit on it, okay? And then we're moving the pocket so the field's closed, right?
Right.
Hey guys, listen. Defense, listen up. Listen up. We're about to go flex. We're gonna go flex. Six, okay? Hey, come on, 3-by-1, check 9. All right, here we go.
With not much time left, Sotelaire going to work. 14 yards to Askia Jahad. then the keeper for six more to the LC 14 with just 3 seconds left. The game will come down to the leg of Dan Tryon from 31 yards out. The Wildcats lose the game 25-22, but earn the respect of one of the top teams in Division III.
Great game, brother. Great game.
We ain't gonna drop our heads. You understand me? We still have a long season. You're a great team. And we're fixing to go win this conference. You just got the respect of the nation. That team's been in the semifinals the last 4 years. You know you're good. You know you're a good football team. You know you're a great team. We're going to take 24 hours, and we're going to hurt. It hurts. This game is going to make us. This game will make our season. You understand me? It'll make our season. Let's keep fighting. Let's keep fighting. You're Louisiana College. Let's keep doing what we're doing. Keep doing the little things right. You hear me? The little things right. I'm proud of you. Father, thank you for who you are. Lord, you're the strength of our lives in victory and in defeat. Lord, let us learn every lesson from this game. Make us better from it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
A lot of seniors upset. We know we gave a good example. Like we can keep up with the best in the nation. We'll be there. You can expect us to go far in conference and do good in conference. So
they came out really hard and they gave us a really playoff look, you know, real feel for what the playoffs are going to be like. I feel like we both had really good contests and, you know, they just came out on top. So
we're going into tomorrow and get better. We got conference start next week and we take care of conference and we most likely going to see them guys again. That's our goal. We still got 12 weeks to play and that's how we're looking at it.
We got our feet wet. We're learning as we're going. Trust me, next week is going to be it's going to be on next week.
Together on three, together on three. One, two, three.
Together.
We good, dog. I promise y'all, we good.
Coming off their heartbreaking 25-22 loss to number 6 Wesley, the Louisiana College Wildcats begin Sunday with the Unity Council meeting.
If everybody in this room felt like I did last night, we will never lose again. I can promise you that. So we're about to start conference. We're not going to lose anymore.
Before turning their focus to the next opponent, Howard Payne, the Wildcats voicing some final thoughts about the game they had just lost.
Don't hold y'all heads, man. We are great. Like Reggie said, we are. I told some of the guys on defense last night, our defense is physical. I see why they don't hit us in practice. They are physical. Do not hang out heads, man. It's pain outside this game. Love each other, bro. Remember that.
What I heard today was bridge building. We got great leaders, man. We got great leaders. I didn't have to show up. You guys have this team. Seniors, you lead us. You take us to the promised land of 2012. I'm proud of every guy in this room, from the least to the guy who would be supposedly the best. We got a 24-hour rule around here. It'll be 24 hours since last night, and not long. We ain't gonna hurt after 24 hours. And we ain't gonna celebrate for more than 24 hours when we're celebrating. There's gonna be a lot of celebrating around here before this year's over, a lot. So the 24-hour rule is no matter what, 24 hours, it's done. You hear me?
Despite the 24-hour rule that says a game is to be forgotten as preparation is made for the next week, the game film from LC's loss to Wesley will still yield some valuable insights and learning.
Ace, Zelda, fast right. Why didn't you throw the back here?
I saw him. I didn't even see the linebacker coming over. I saw that guy slot area just go outside of him. So I was gonna.
What do you mean you didn't see?
I was focused on the slot area, is what I was looking at.
You'll see it from the wide, not from the tight. But if you were, when your eyes go here and you see him streaking, look up top.
Okay.
Guys, this extra effort. Look at Tank, Ryan. Look at our offensive line. Our defense is playing fantastic football, right? Give our defense a chance. Tank's coming from a standstill. That linebacker catches it full speed running downhill. He cuts him off, on the 2-yard line? Give our defense a chance. That's how you play 15. Give your defense a chance.
That was a great effort. That was a great effort.
See that?
What made you jump here?
I thought it was high.
How'd you think that was high?
I was just preparing for it, I guess.
I hit you in the neck, man. That's a great job, Skinny. So nice.
With most of the offensive starters crammed into Coach Dunn's office, the session unveils a few themes that will carry into the next game.
I mean, they knew what we were about to run, and we still ran it. Boy, that's good right there. Darren Moore is nasty. God's good stuff. Jamie, give us another shot here, man.
Yes, sir.
Throw the sucker out of bounds or throw the out. Just throw the out. Throw it out of bounds. Look, it's over, right? Let's go get 7. You hear me?
Yes, sir.
Let's go get 7 of them.
Ready, hit.
Back on the practice field, the struggle that has been the LC passing game so far continuing to show itself leading up to Howard Payne. Neither the starter Bunting nor the backup Tim Curry.
Why took you throw the freaking out? It's wide open!
Escaping their head coach's loss of patience on this day.
All right, man, listen to me. Can't throw picks. Can't throw picks. You hear me? That's everybody. We ain't throwing picks. Throw completions. That's the rule. Quarterbacks, do not throw picks. So, we ain't gonna throw picks. Stop throwing freaking picks. Throw completions to our guys. That's what we want to do. Okay? I ain't talking to you guys, but one of these days, you'll be the guy. Or one of you. We don't throw picks. Understand me? Protect the football. Protect the football.
Q's on 3. 1, 2, 3.
Q's.
Hey, Cook.
We want to welcome students and parents and thank you for attending today.
Heading into their fourth game of the season, the Wildcats will be met with very different conditions as they host Howard Payne, a dreary rain-filled day, and but a fraction of the fans who filled the stands the week before.
I'm so ready to get these over.
The question for the Wildcats, could they come close to matching their intensity from that week before?
They just made it worse for themselves today.
We out here today, man. These boys don't look like they ready. They all look ready, man. Finna do it though, big guy.
Today's game captains for the Wildcats.
On the opening kickoff, two players who are becoming coverage hitmen for the Wildcats this season, sophomore Bo Brewer, number 40, and junior Ty Carter, number 35. No questioning their intensity on that play, nor that of senior linebacker Nate Jansen early in the game. But on the offensive side of the football, the early season struggles continue. With the raindrops falling on everyone's heads, the LC defense making a big play early in the game. Howard Payne quarterback Tony Head, pursued by LC's Otis Chatham, fumbling the football, sophomore Preston Tebow eventually falling on it, LC taking over at the Yellow Jackets 19. So an early opportunity for the Wildcats, but as Bunting goes back to pass, losing the handle, a fumble recovered by Jeremy Masterson for Howard Payne, scoring opportunity wasted for LC. The Wildcat defense will get it right back though, Head picked off by junior Dominic Graham, his return to the Yellow Jacket 21. This time, Dennis Dunn electing to keep things on the ground, and Ryan Montague bursting through the line for 19 yards, giving LC a first and goal at the 2-yard line.
Ryan Montague, just short of the goal line.
Next play, it's Montague finding the seam behind that big offensive line. First score of the game, putting LC up 7-0 with 7 minutes left in the first quarter. A Howard Payne field goal cuts LC's lead to 7-3 early in the second quarter, and needing to get some kind of momentum on offense, the Cats keep it on the ground. Another big run for Montague, this one for 20 yards to the Howard Payne 24. But LC fails to convert from there. First, the normally sure-handed Kyle Gallion dropping what could have been a touchdown pass. Then facing 4th and 9, the Cats passing up the field goal, but Bunting losing the handle again. The fumble, pushing it all the way out to the 46-yard line before Wayne Harris brings down Donald Preston. Next possession, more struggles for Bunting. What should have been an interception dropped by Maurice Young. And later on the drive, another fourth down situation from their own 48. This time Bunting throwing behind Gallion. Still 7-3 LC.
All right, they're still in 20.
For the Wildcats, their defense remains the story of the game so far. Despite the drop of a potential interception by promising freshman Richard Jefferson, the white shirts turning away another scoring threat with no damage done. With just over 2 minutes left in the first half, the Wildcats offense needing some kind of spark, getting one here. Bunting, a screen to Gallion. And perhaps with that touchdown drop still on his mind, Gallion somehow escapes the pack and does the rest. A sensational 68-yard touchdown play. The Wildcats with a little more breathing room now, leading at 14-3.
Hey, love you, boy.
We actually just threw that in this week as a screen. And, you know, with our line, you know, coming out, I wouldn't want to run behind any other guys in our line. You know, they know how to block, and they just open up a hole, and I had to make it happen.
With one more stop by the LC defense, the Wildcats getting a final offensive series to end the half, but whatever hope they had for that quickly leaving when Bunting is sacked in what could have been the toughest half of his career at LC so far. Despite a 14-3 lead, Coach Dunn deciding it's time to make a major change.
I thought we needed a spark offensively, and of course we worked and have been working, Tim, all year, you know, and I felt like he deserved a chance.
Coming at you.
Tim Curry, the 6'4 senior out of Benton, Louisiana, who attended Elysian Fields High School in Texas, was once ranked in the top 20 of high school quarterbacks his senior year.
Had 8 Division I offers, and I go to El Paso thinking, all right, I'm about to go out here, you know, be the star, do all this. Well, I go out there, you know, kind of got homesick after 2 years, and my great-grandma kind of had some issues, you know, going on. Decided to move back closer to Stephen F. Austin. Well, you know, I moved closer home thinking everything was going to be good. I was there for 1 year, all the coaches leave, you know. They bring in a triple option type coaching staff, and I'm sitting there like, man, you know, I can't do this.
But Curry's college career to this point hadn't found that perfect landing spot. From Texas El Paso, transferring to Stephen F. Austin, and then last year to LC, where he would spend the entire season waiting in the wings behind Bunting.
I never thought I would be, you know, here at Louisiana College, but just the people and stuff, it seems like God kind of like led me here just to kind of get closer to him, kind of meet new people, you know, and just be around a wonderful family.
And back to the game with LC's lead at an uncomfortable 14-6 following another Howard Payne field goal. And Dunn wanting to get a spark for his team, Curry gets the call and makes an immediate impact. For Curry, two passes, 64 yards, and the touchdown to Cortland Bell. LC's lead 21-6, and a completely new energy is evident.
What I was planning on doing is just coming out, getting our rhythm back, trying to find our identity, and trying to put points up on the board. And offensive line did a great job blocking for me. Receivers made, you know, great routes, or ran great routes, and I was just, you know, put the ball in. Let them make plays.
Tim has a swagger. He has the quarterback swagger, and it kind of fed off on everyone else. And after that first touchdown, it just kind of flowed after that. So it was great. I mean, I don't know what to say about the future, but today Tim performed.
That energy carries to the defense as well, as on Howard Payne's third play after the kickoff, the fumble on the exchange, Dominique Graham falls on it. LC takes over at the Howard Payne 42. On 2nd and 10, it's Curry for Bell once again. And a 28-6 LC lead. For Curry, the only blemish on an otherwise nearly perfect half, this interception by Howard Payne's Maurice Young. But for the game, Curry 8 of 13, 188 yards, including this completion to senior Justin Miller. And the Wildcats finish the scoring on the ground, sophomore Reggie Sims from 5 yards out. LC wins it by a final score of 38-6, improving to 3-1 after 4 games. And now the question moving forward, who will be LC's starting quarterback, as it appears Curry's time may have finally come.
Here's the bottom line. We got two very good quarterbacks, and you know, they'll both, you know, continue to work and practice, and whoever has a hot hand will be the quarterback that'll play. And I think, you know, we're fortunate in that that position doesn't have to win for us. It just can't lose for us. We're good around that position.
Hopefully I can, you know, maybe get a few more reps here and there, and if not, then, I mean, it is what it is. As long as we win, I mean, I'm a happy camper.
If anything, it will push both of them, because we have two great quarterbacks who have a chance to go for 5 or 6 touchdowns any game. So when one of them's down, we bring them up. I mean, we just got to piggyback each other along, because it's a long season and we don't have time for divisions.
With that said, you got the W, the 1-0 in conference, and that's what matters at this point. Let's come back next week, and let's keep fighting and keep battling, and let's be 2-0. It's all about win and win. When do we win?
Today.
Win.
Today.
Win.
Today.
That's what it's about.
With a couple of days to digest the developments of the Howard Payne game, LC coach Dennis Dunn meets with his Unity Council, the team-approved leaders, to discuss the quarterback situation and his decision to start Tim Curry for the next game at East Texas Baptist. It is the decision the council says it will fully support their coach in making, and they won't let it divide the team.
That decisiveness is key, because it lets your team know that you're going to make a firm decision and you're going to stand behind that decision. And you're going to be a man and stand behind the decision that you make. Whether that decision ends up wrong or whether it ends up right, you felt it was right at that time.
Not making decisions based off emotion also. I mean, in the heat of the battle, in the heat of the game, heat of life, you know, we all men, we all going to be married one day. So, you know, when you have a family and your wife looks at you, you know, things might be tough, but you got to let her know that it's going to be okay. Even in the back of your mind, you know how you're gonna do it. She has to have that decisiveness. That she has to have that on that knowing that something's gonna happen.
It's a quality that we're all blessed with. Everybody don't have it. Everybody can't lead. Man, it's tough. you get put in some situations like Coach said. I haven't been a leader all my life, but the couple years I've been in leadership roles, man, you get behind the scenes and this is where the deep stuff comes in, that the stuff that you can't see out there when we're playing on Saturdays and stuff like that. And that's what's so unique and special about these meetings. And I enjoy them. Just keep on leading, man.
And chemistry and unity is our greatest strength. It's a cliche, but it's real. Our unity is our greatest strength. And every organization that falls, where they normally fall from where? From the inside. And that's how the enemy works, man. He can't get you from the outside. He'll begin to try to destroy your heart.
Let your will be done through us, Father God. We'll thank you in advance, Father God, because it's going to be a good journey. It's going to be something that we can tell people about for years to come, Father God. And just once again, I thank you for using us. And that's in your name, I pray. Amen.
Decisions made in the coach's office have to translate onto the field, and for this week of practice, the decision to change quarterbacks seems to be embraced by the offense. As the named starter, it means Curry will get the more meaningful reps, working more with the offensive starting line, backs, and receivers. And for the LC linemen, it means having to put aside personal feelings. A group especially tight with Bunting will now have to block the same way for Curry.
Whatever quarterback we had in there, we had to win with. And whether it be Jamie or Tim, I mean, it was just, you know, we knew as O-line and as an offense, whoever we had out there, we had to perform with.
Jamie knew that we still had his back if he was in the game and off the field and all that stuff as well. I mean, you just have to be very mature about the situation.
And football is hard to play with friends sometimes because you have to worry about hurting their feelings or stuff. But Jamie knew that the game was bigger than himself, and so he told us, as a line, he's like, look, do what y'all gotta do. Y'all have to compete.
For Jamie Bunting, the week will, as much as anything, become a personal challenge, where every mistake becomes magnified in the light of its new context.
I think sometimes to get the best out of a person, you have to take away something from them. And when you take away what they love, and when they get it back, they know they don't want to lose it again.
As a competitor, it was probably one of the toughest things I've ever been through. I mean, I haven't had a rough life as some of the people on the team, and I haven't really, I guess you could say, fought for much in my life. But once I got benched, it clicked that nerve in my brain and in my body to where, like, after that, I was just like, I'm not taking this, and we're not losing any more of these games. We're going out there, and every game's going to have my 100% best effort. And I'm not gonna quit.
Just knowing Jamie and having been with him for 3 years and knowing his spirit and his competitive spirit, I needed to get his attention, but he needed it more than football. It was about life for Jamie. Jamie won a battle in his heart that he will be able to carry with him throughout the rest of his life. And he won some spiritual battles in that his identity is not attached to his performance.
Through it all, the two quarterbacks will have to learn to balance their own relationship.
You can't let football and stuff like that come in between, you know, your relationship between somebody. Jamie's a great guy. Don't have anything against him at all, you know, and hope the best for him. But, of course, when you step on the field, you know, you're out there competing.
Above all, both quarterbacks know that the important thing is the team. And they demonstrate that commitment by staying after practice to continue to improve their timing with the starting receivers and even to work to help develop some of the younger ones. Alongside the quarterback story, this week will be dominated by talk of the claw, the border claw. And the battle for the border claw has become part of lore of LC football as a symbol of the rivalry between the Tigers of ETBU and the Wildcats of Louisiana College. The proximity of the two schools, about 150 miles separating them, the closest rival the Wildcats have, has given this rivalry added meaning. Most of the LC assistant coaches have played in the rivalry themselves.
You take pride in that. That's ours. It ain't theirs. It's ours. It ain't going there. No player on their team has seen it. No player on their team has ever got to touch that thing. Make sure it keeps happening like that.
But only Director of Football Operations Vance Morris has been there for them all.
It was made by Matt Miller's grandfather. Matt Miller played here the first 4 years of our program, 2000, 2001, 2002, and 2003. He was a four-year starter, was an all-conference player. played a year for the Kansas City Chiefs, a year for the Seattle Seahawks. He's the only player we've had to actually play in the NFL. And the grandfather made it. Their family donated it. The two presidents agreed upon it. It's exchanged, you know, after every game by the team that wins it. Now, there's been a lot of controversy about it. We've actually played, this will be the 13th game, and it's tied, the series is tied at 6-6.
With the season nearing its midway point, there's always potential for practices to fall into a rut, but the LC coaches are careful to make sure it won't happen again. In some cases, they do try to make it fun.
Jared Myers. Sir, stand up. Jared Myers petitioned for a later practice tomorrow, but because it was Jared, we're going to keep it on the same time. We're on the field at 5:15 a.m. We're going to keep our schedule the same tomorrow. You understand? Keeping the schedule the same. Good job. Good try, Jared. All right. Grandma Dean, stand up. Dutchtown alma mater. 1, 2, 3.
Dutchtown, dear alma mater, your sons and daughters pledge to thee. Purple, silver, black on your colors. That's all I know.
I'm a college student, bro. He'll
take us to Outback. If,
it'll bring us closer.
Outback, yeah. Good luck with that. Good luck with that.
Outback on three. Outback. 1, 2, 3.
Outback. But in other cases, it's through discipline. The slightest infraction, being late, forgetting equipment, missing study hall, draws a not-so-slight form of punishment.
All right, guys, listen up. If I just said your name, you got 100 yards of seals, okay? The seal, you can't use your feet. Don't use your feet, okay? I'll go ahead and give you a little hint. It's easier if you stay on your toes and swivel, okay? I'm just being honest. If I see you use your feet, though, we'll just start it over. All right, so don't cheat it, okay? Start behind the line, carry all the way through. Seals on your hands, off your knees. It's like so, okay? That's all we got. Oh, yeah, wobble, wobble, baby. Yeah.
All right, I'm gonna chill for a minute.
Let's go. What?
I'm
on camera. I can't stop. I'm on camera. I can't stop. All right, 10 yards. 10 yards. It's 10 yards.
Let's go, let's go, let's go!
If there's one thing we've seen these players enjoy, it's the chance to eat. And on this Thursday night before ETBU, Pineville's city marshal, Larry Jean, a big supporter of LC Athletics, renews one of his own traditions, feeding the players a barbecue chicken dinner. For the LC players and coaches, it's also the chance to relax and enjoy some fellowship, from the oldest to the youngest.
Say hi, Boost.
Hi, Max.
Nathan Matchett, future Wildcat.
For college students, getting to eat anything beside cafeteria food is a welcome change.
Wayne Harris. So, how are you, Wayne?
I'm good.
No beans?
But not everyone gets to enjoy the dessert.
You want the cookie?
No, he don't.
You want the cookie?
You got to answer his mama. You think I yell at you?
Hey, you want the cookie? There you go, Nate.
Don't
there
do it,
go.
Nate. Don't,
you
Nate.
Go,
don't do it, Nate.
Take the cookie.
Nate,
take
don't do
the
it.
Cookie, Nate. You laugh. What's up?
Say, go get the claw, Phil. Bring the claw back home.
Gotcha.
Another cool night will meet the Wildcats as the team arrives in Marshall, Texas to face ETBU. Phil Ford may enjoy giving cookies to babies off the field, but once he's on the field, it's a totally different demeanor. Well, most of the time.
Cause this what we do, Big Al.
The practice of stalking his opponent at midfield along with teammate Richard Logan is something Ford is hoping will send a message.
Yeah, that's him. That's him.
I just want to let the opposing team know that we here, and this ain't no, it's not going to be no cakewalk. It's about to be 60 minutes of pure chaos on your field.
Coming into the 2012 season as the reigning American Southwest Conference Defensive Lineman of the Year, Peter Phil Ford is without question the most devastating member of the Louisiana College defense. His game is violence, and it's a game he's had since he was young.
I seen the park for the first time. I was like, I want to be in that park, Dad. And I remember my mama bringing me up there one time, and I think she bought my football stuff from like a regular rink-a-dink store, because I had the team was blue and gold. I had on green and white, and the coach put me in for the first time. I forgot what the drill was called, but it's two lines and two people in the middle of the lines. You just go head up, and I never forget. I just went. I didn't have no can of where I just went, and they called me the Green Hornet. And from then, it was just like, whoever in front of me, you about to get somebody happen to you, because that's how I, from when I was young, it's just that when I just strap up, it's just a different person.
Ford came to LC in 2010 after thinking his career was over. Originally from New Orleans, Ford, like many, found his family displaced after Hurricane Katrina, and his high school football played in Lafayette instead. But when college opportunities fell through, Ford thought himself to be done with the game. That is, until he ran into a former teammate.
At the end of the day, if you're just living life and not doing it for nothing, you're not living at all. And so that was pretty much the change, that I was doing something with my life that I really wanted to do, and not just living life for nothing.
Ford made an immediate impact. 7 sacks in 2010 as a freshman, 6.5 more in 2011, along with 10 tackles for loss, and 65 tackles overall. But it's the presence Ford brings that keeps opposing quarterbacks nervous and aware of his presence at all times.
But the good thing about it is, while y'all worrying about me, y'all forgot I got 10 more brothers out there that's coming for you. And that's the good and the bad part about it. And that's why I love the game of football, because it's not just a I, it's a we. And while you looking at me, you forgetting about them. And so that's the good and the bad part about it. I love it.
As for this game with ETBU, it will bring out one of Ford's best of the season and one of ETBU's best as well. It also brings out one of LC's many white shirt alumni to speak to the defense prior to the contest. Brandon Singleton was an LC linebacker from 2003 to 2007.
About every August, when y'all start fall camp, I get out my white shirt and I remember what it was like to be where y'all are sitting. Give anything to have that back, but just know the person sitting next to you, sitting behind you, sitting in front of you, this guy's is the tie that binds. All right, short, sweet, to the point. Beat ETBU.
And not to be forgotten, the meaning of the rivalry. In the visitor's locker, Curry preparing for his first start as a Wildcat. It will happen only 30 miles from where he played high school football. For Bunting, doing what he can to help keep himself ready and to get his teammates ready as well. As game time nears, the Wildcats trickling onto the field, and by the time the full complement is out, it's clear this game will hold much more intensity than the previous week did.
I heard we ain't lightning, boy. That was
LC up in this thing, baby. It's about to be a big fight. Let's go.
All day, baby. It's going to be a great one today, baby.
Hey, one good thing about this game, we don't have to act like we like ETBU. We don't even have to act like it. It's already understood. Battle of the Claw, that's our claw. I don't think they're gonna ever get it back.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
1-5, Dominique, holler at me, baby. Holler at me. Gotta get it in. ETBU, who?
Game day, baby. Here we go.
I think every one of us understands what's at stake here. Let me tell you what it's not about. It ain't about a claw. It ain't about ETBU. It's about the next step. Understand? That's what's at stake. They talk about a rivalry game all they want.
The only thing that makes this rivalry is it's the next game toward our ultimate goal, a dream. We have a dream. Don't let anybody steal your dream. Father, I pray that you strengthen us tonight. Thank you that you've already gone before us. You've prepared the way. As we go into battle, let us bring you honor, bring you glory, and let us honor each other with strength and honor. In Christ's name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Let's go do this. Let's go do this. Let's go do this.
Hey, let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
As kickoff arrives, the Wildcats will receive first, meaning Curry and the offense will try to continue their momentum from the second half of last week's win. But from the outset, Curry struggling to find that same rhythm. Though this play goes for 10 yards to Ryan Montague in the first down, the miss of a wide-open Cortland Bell looms larger, especially after the drive bogs down and LC is forced to punt. Later in the quarter, Curry looking to get something going deep for Demario Parker, broken up by Dominique Bailey. Wildcats punting again, and Curry showing the cold hand so far. In a back-and-forth struggle still in the first quarter, ETBU catching their first major break on this play, the scramble by quarterback Seth Hubbard. Out of bounds, looks like LC's Reggie Calhoun held up on the play, but called for a personal foul, 15 more yards, putting it at the LC 47. And the Tigers draw first blood when Hubbard finds Kwame Spikes for the touchdown. ETBU up 7-0 as the first quarter comes to an end. For Curry, things go from bad to worse on LC's next possession, looking deep for Parker, but intercepted by Dominique Bailey at the ETBU 15. When the Wildcats get it back, this time Curry is sacked by ETBU's Jordan Hayes on the blitz. Then on 3rd and 19, no choice but to go deep. Curry looking again for Parker and again picked off by Bailey. And whatever Curry had the week before, it seems to have disappeared on this night. For ETBU, their offense has slowed down as well, forward with the pressure, but the Tigers will punt it back. This time, however, Curry not emerging at quarterback. Instead, it's Jamie Bunting back behind center. And like Curry the week before in this game, it is Bunting who provides the spark. When Ryan Montague takes his handoff and bursts up the near sideline, LC in position to tie the 38-yard run, making it first and goal at the ETBU 6-yard line. LC will not be able to punch it in, though, bunting for Bell, but Cortland can't hang on. Olivares' 32-yard field goal will have LC trailing 7-3 with 6.5 minutes left in the half. One player who is enjoying being back in his home state, the special teams assassin, Bo Brewer. Looking to get the ball back for the offense, the LC defense comes through again. This time Hubbard intercepted by Pop Frederick. LC takes over at the ETBU 35. Wildcats not content with the field goal this time. Bunting to Bell, good for 12 yards and a first down at the 11. Then on 3rd and 9, Bunting finding Kyle Galleon, another Texas player open in the middle of the field. Galleon practically walking in, LC back in front at 10-7.
Tim came out a little slow. Jamie kept his head up. He came in and just did his job. So it's going to help us having two quarterbacks throughout the rest of the season.
I mean, I just basically prepare for everything, any scenario that could possibly come up because, I mean, you never know. And one thing that I've learned from this is the amount of adversity that God will put you through will never outweigh the outcome.
LC's defense shutting down ETBU the rest of the half. Dominique Graham with the sack of Hubbard. That will set up Oliveris for another 35-yard field goal. LC's lead is 6 at the half, 13-7.
We can get rhythm, take those short outside routes, and just go.
Drive them.
And keep flying around having fun, man. You got 30 more minutes to keep the claw. You got 30 more minutes to keep the claw, guys. It's on us.
Keep doing the deal. Let's play 30 more minutes. You hear me?
Yes, sir.
Let's go.
All right, guys. Here we go.
In the second half, LC continues to put the pressure on defensively, and it's Ford with a sack here. ETBU forced to kick it away. But another Wildcat drive results in a turnover. Here, Bunting finding Parker for the screen. But as DeMario tries to maneuver upfield, the big hit forcing the fumble, ETBU taking over at the LC 22.
Fumble on the play, the Tigers come up with it.
You're 6'3", man. Remember what we talked about 2 weeks ago? Low man wins, right?
Yes, sir.
You've got to get
low.
Low.
I'm telling you. Just fall. We got the first. Don't worry about the rest. Let's go.
Hey, the good news is we got a heck of a defense.
We good,
right,
man?
One thing about a rivalry game, even for a veteran player, emotions can get the best of you.
It was definitely a physical game. Some things didn't get called. It was a little dirty, kind of on both sides. So it's just a physical game. And I mean, when you got a rivalry like this, it's going to be a brutal game.
As they've done so many times already this season, the Wildcat defense rising up. Reggie Calhoun on the pass defense. ETBU has to settle for a field goal, but LC's lead is cut to 3, 13-10.
With ETBU, even if they're 0-1 whatever, they're going to bring their best game against us. I mean, that was expected, and they came out firing all cylinders. But the biggest part is that we executed our play, and no one panicked, and we got the job done.
As the third quarter reaches its midway point, the Wildcats continuing to scuffle on offense. Finally, with about 5 minutes left in the third, LC moving the football, and it starts with Montague, 21 yards to the ETBU 47. Six plays later, the combination LC's been waiting to see connect in 2012 does. Bunting for Parker. A touchdown strike of 31 yards, 19-10 Wildcats.
Coach Matchett told me that he felt like I had become complacent. He felt like because I had scouts coming and this and that I might have gotten a big head a little bit. I wasn't working as hard as I was, and I took that to heart.
Meanwhile on defense, Phil Ford continuing his most dominant game of the season so far, the sack of Hubbard. ETBU recovers the fumble, but the message has been sent. And as the game shifts to the fourth quarter, LC up 22-10, and for the Cats defense, which had virtually shut down ETBU for three quarters, a bit of a hiccup of a series here. Hubbard to Chad Bowers for 28 yards, and then capping the drive by hitting Roy Denbo for the 10-yard touchdown. LC's lead cut to 5, 22-17. So things getting a little tense for Dunn and the Wildcats, even more so here when Bunting nearly picked off. The Wildcats will have to punt it away with just over 5 minutes left to play. Following a Wildcats punt, ETBU looking for a winning drive, but Hubbard making a big mistake here, and Daniel Hebert is there to make him pay. The huge interception with 3.5 minutes left in the football game.
I look straight to the quarterback to read his eyes. He goes straight to the outside receiver. I see the receiver just does a hitch, and I'm thinking there's no way that's all they're going to throw. I start heading that way, and sure enough, I see him break loose to do a hitch and go, and I was just there to make the play. I'm looking at him catch the ball, you know, and he said he could do his little dance to Bobby B. He did it on the sideline. He's a funny kid, but I like how they play.
Looking to put it away, Bunting facing 3rd and 8, finding Galleon. He takes it across midfield for the huge first down.
Time out.
Let's go. All right, sharp.
All right. Let's go.
Then it's Montague, 31 yards to the ETBU 11. A personal foul on the Tigers will move it down to the 5.
I think we, as the game just went on, it was just we were just getting that momentum, and like they wasn't gonna stop us every play, so we just right play calling at the right time.
And using their favorite short yardage play, the Wildcats get the score as Moore pulls, takes out the linebacker, and Montague is in with a 29-17 lead, and just a minute 10 left, LC can finally breathe. Including Jamie Bunting, what a comeback from one game ago.
I did some soul searching this week and I had to find out who I really am, because I mean, this is being here for 5 years and then getting taken out like that. It was just, I mean, it was a rough situation, and I searched for God, and then I mean, just everyone around me, the support system around me, just believed in me and let me keep confidence in myself throughout the whole thing.
For other LC players, it's the start of a celebration.
24 seconds left, man. 29-17. We whooped them, boy.
LC's defense will close it out. Fittingly, it's Ford, this time with an assist from Preston Tebow, his third sack of the game to go along with 9 tackles. The Wildcats hit the midway point of their season, improving to 4-1, defeating East Texas Baptist 29-17, and keeping the Border Claw once again in Pineville.
The energy was high from the start, so I think this year was kind of, it meant more because we actually have a bigger dream. So it meant a little more today.
Do we love each other? We love each other. We keep fighting. We keep getting better.
And for Coach Dunn, any hard feelings among his quarterbacks is something he looks to head off.
Keep getting better. You keep getting better. You understand? You guys make each other better. I promise you, you do. Keep doing that, okay? Proud of you. That's a great win, man. That's a great win.
But for the remainder of 2012, Jamie Bunting will be the starter.
You know what next week is?
Even as they celebrate this win, the Wildcats can't help but turn their attention to the next week. A showdown game in the back of their mind all year. The crew of Mary Hardin-Baylor coming to Pineville as the number 2 team in the nation.
1, 2, 3. Bye, bye.
In the 12 years of Louisiana college football since bringing back the program in 2000, one team has proven the unbeatable foe, Mary Hardin-Baylor. Known as the Crew, UMHB has also become the class of the American Southwest Conference. LC's best chance to end the domination came in 2010, the year of Ben McLaughlin. In what was arguably the best game ever played in Pineville, McLaughlin threw for 368 yards and 5 touchdowns. But it was the only bad pass McLaughlin threw that day that proved the difference. A 4th-and-2 play from the Crew's 3-yard line, intercepted by Bronson Shaw, stealing what would have been the biggest win in the modern era of LC football. In 2011, LC headed to Belton, Texas as the number 19 team in the country, facing the number 4 Crew. LC would score the first 10 points of the game with upset on their minds. But a collection of stalled series and turnovers resulted in 36 unanswered points as Mary Hardin-Baylor took a 36-10 win. For Jamie Bunting, an especially tough day where he was just 15 of 37 for 193 yards and an interception. As the Wildcats begin their prep for this week, they know if they hope to knock off this giant, turnovers will not be an option.
Let's go, hurry up! Hurry up! Hurry up!
It may not have been said in as many words, but the desire to beat Mary Hardin-Baylor added attention to practice this day, and few were spared their head coach's impatience over a lack of perfection.
God almighty, no! Move the ball! Move the ball!
Let's go! North, north, north! Go north!
Missing 79! Two south!
Coach, I would have cut him in the game.
But as practice comes to an end, Coach Dunn brings the team back to their constant source of strength, their bond with each other, and their program's dedication to play for God.
In the spirit of sense, Father God, I just pray that you continue just to touch our souls, Father God. Just show us your face, Father. Show us you're real, Lord. And just be with this team, Father God. And that's in your name I pray. Amen.
Brothers on 3. 1, 2, 3.
Brothers.
With the kickoff for the Mary Hardin-Baylor game set for 11 a.m. Saturday due to conference rules, Coach Dunn changes things up for the Friday night before the game. The River Outreach Center is not only a church a few blocks from the LC campus, it happens to be the church that Coach Dunn serves as pastor. To take the edge off any pressure and provide for a time of bonding, Coach Dunn's church opens its arms to the LC players, providing a pregame meal and a time of spiritual encouragement.
This is Dr. David Remedios. Let's give him a Louisiana College welcome.
Sadly enough, most of us spend most of our time with people who want to keep us in our past or want to keep us in our present. But there are people that got sensitive. For example, Coach, he's someone that will try to draw the best out of you. He's going to take determination, it's going to take work. You're going to have to do things you don't want to necessarily do, but he's preparing you to win a game. But it's much more than a game of football. There is something in life that God wants you to accomplish, and you need to apply that same principle and discipline.
Mixing Christianity with athleticism is nothing new in sports, but at Louisiana College, it has become an inseparable blend. Everything the Wildcats do is bathed in prayer.
I thank you that there are world changers in this room. Those that will leave Louisiana College and make an impact into every venue of life.
And Dunn seems to put every moment into some kind of spiritual context. It's part of the ministry for him that is coaching.
I think what these guys see is they get to watch a man who is flawed, who doesn't claim to be perfect in any way. Well, even, you know, I'm going to point out my flaws. And a man who will be honest about, you know, I'm going to fail you guys because I'm here. I'm going to let you down. And I'm acknowledging that. I'm not an end-all for you. But I get to point them to Jesus. I say, you know what? If you'll keep your eyes on him, I won't let you down. And they get to see me walk through life, through the ups and downs you know, we get to do life together.
Growing up in today's society, I mean, it's for young guys, it's rough because you don't have too many role models, and you don't have people you can look up to that are Christians and that want you to do well in life. Because some people in today's society, I mean, you see them and you're doing well, and they're like, "Hey, man, why don't you come on and get drunk with me tonight? You know, why don't you come let's go party? You know," and they're a more of a Let's do the right things, and let's take this the way God wants us to take it. And that's, I mean, you can respect a man like that, and I mean, it's just amazing.
The coaches care about you first as a person. They care about what you're doing in your personal life. They care about what you're doing with your social media. They care about the fact of, are you going to be a good husband one day? Are you going to make a difference in the community? They care about that kind of stuff. And it's hard to understand as a young man, but when you grow and you see that care is what will make you a better person, you appreciate it all the more, you know what I mean? And it took for me to buy in, to really understand what this brotherhood is all about, because we don't have the attractions and everything everybody else has. We only have each other, and that just makes it all the more special.
I've never been to a private school before. I'm a public kid, so, you know, a lot of stuff was different. I didn't know what chapel was, so for the first couple weeks, I wasn't really going to chapel because I didn't know what it was. Like, I just felt a different bond here, like a brotherhood. You know, the coaches and the players all act different than at other schools that I've been to. At other schools, it's kind of like business. It's kind of like, you here for me, but I don't really need you. But here it's like, I want to see you grow. I want to see you become a man in life. So it's a big difference.
And I need to grow strong spiritually through here, because I probably wouldn't be this close to God if I would have accepted and went to Grambling State or anything like that. It wouldn't have been this close. I would have got out the church instead of staying in it. You know what I'm saying? And I appreciate everything that this school has done for me.
They have you doing stuff to where you can't do nothing but get your mind right. If you don't, that's on you. Like, you just, they're not, I don't want to say they forcing you to be a better person, but just by the stuff that, you know, that you go through as you hit, you gonna be a better person leaving it.
Well, it was kind of new to me. Not saying that I didn't pray outside of football, but whenever I came into football, we would never, you know, nothing was ever talked about God, God this, God that, praying after practice, you know.
My school, Capital High, coming from a high school that's in the middle of two hoods, you know, and that's kind of the crowd I hung around. So, and seeing that my mom really, really wanted me to come to a place that was Christian-like, and their goal was Jesus Christ, you know, and God. So I went for it.
I think a lot of people as coming through this program has met God, you know. It's not an awkward thing for me at all. I really, that's one thing I liked about the program was how they handled themselves, you know.
They're never pressuring on you. That's what they don't want to do. They don't want to pressure on, but they just want to show you reality, what is real, what can help you, what can make you be successful in life.
Especially Coach Dunn, because Coach Dunn, there's one thing more than football he loves, and that's God, and that's his faith. And you got to respect that as a man.
I came from a very strict Catholic background, and so we don't talk about our spiritual feelings to other people, you know, and I guess coming to Louisiana College, I just was kind of closed-minded, but the spiritual aspect of the team is what makes this team so unique. You know, you could say that doesn't have a really place in football, but it does, you know, in every aspect of life that there should be some kind of spiritual connection. And
when I go in the game, I want to have a clear heart, you know, I want to know that if I died on the field, I'm going to heaven.
To be honest, once I left New Orleans, I really never like went to church like talking about it. I was just going through our life, like pretty much lost. And when I came up here, I started buying in and feeding into what the coaches and the college was doing, like going to church, praying every day, doing this to better yourself in life. And I feel like I owe the coaches and this college more than they owe me. Like it's all fun when they say we thank you for doing this, but in all actuality, I'm thanking them because I never had this opportunity to be the person I am now if I'd never came up here. And I thank God every day, and I also thank Coach Dunn and the rest of the coaching staff. And Coach Buck, he's not here, I thank all of them because I honestly don't know what I'd be doing right now in life if I haven't made that decision to come up here. That's how I pretty much see it.
And they really don't know the benefits they'll get from it until they go out into another setting and you'll be like, man, I did this before, you know? And it'll be in their job, not only in football. I mean, this thing's about life at the end of the day, because one day football's gonna stop. It's all gonna run out, and it ends up about life. And that's what this program sets you up for, life, to be honest with you.
And that's all that I am, is a servant of Almighty God, masquerading as a ball coach. And with that, it's been fun to see how God would use it.
But I want to tell you.
Back at the Rock, on the night before the Mary Hardin-Baylor game, Coach Dunn's longtime personal friend, Dolores Winder, is on hand to pray and encourage the Wildcat players on the eve of their biggest game of the season.
And when he said no, Jesus took one look around.
And with faith in football, the theme for the night, one last message from the head coach.
Let me just say this real quick before we go. On paper, nobody believes you got a shot. I've read all the pundits. They didn't even mention your name on Division III as even a close game. D3.com. You're not even mentioned. I'm glad they're ranked where they are. They're the highest they've ever been ranked when we played them. What better time? I don't want to beat them when they're down. Well, they're down. I want to beat them when they're at their best. What better time? Yeah. Just get some rest. What?
Yeah, Miss Grimmin, no church.
A game day morning is always filled with personal routines, but for this game, even more. The Wildcats understand what this moment means and their chance to make history. And while some lock in with intense focus, others look to keep things a little more loose.
Atmosphere. I ain't been around like they were saying, your blood boiling. Your mind boiling last night. I ready to ball, man.
That's my dog.
Just listen. This is me. I'm in my bed. It's sitting on my bed.
Paranormal activity.
I hear him breathing.
You sleep like that?
Brandon Allen.
He got some good sleep last night, man. Yeah, he got some good rest.
I'm talking all night.
One, two. Hey, game day, baby. Let's go.
With an early kickoff, 11 a.m., everything is tighter this day. The Whiteshirt Pride meeting features former Wildcat Max Mahaffey, a linebacker who played from 2001 to 2004.
I know we all come from different walks of life, different parts of the country, all over the place. I don't care what high school you went to, what your hometown is, what your mascot was, nothing. I don't care about that. Right now you live in Pineville, Louisiana. You wear orange and blue, and you play defense for the Louisiana College Wildcats. Nobody can ever take that away from you. So when you go out there today, 11 o'clock, from the first snap to the end whistle, let them know how we play defense. Make a statement today. You got a chance to do something very special today. Make a statement. Win today.
Following Mahaffey's speech and words from co-defensive coordinator Justin Charles, a more impromptu speech, and one that anyone present to hear it won't soon forget.
All right. Everybody good? Anybody got anything they want to say? Any of you seniors got anything y'all want to say?
I got something to say. It's been on my mind for a good little minute, man. All you hear about is these people talking about, you know what I'm saying, that they better than us in all kind of ways, all shapes and sizes. That we not tough enough and all that. But y'all, what I noticed in every game they played, they never played to the end because they was on the sideline. Every game we played, we was in the game to the end. They never fought for four quarters yet. They never did. They never fought for four quarters yet. They on the sideline. We played every game for four quarters. Every game. Cal, you sat on the sideline yet? You sat on the sideline yet, Shaq? Grant, you sat on the sideline yet? Richard, you sat on the sideline yet? They sat on the sideline. We never sat on the sideline. We never did. Four quarters we've been fighting, dog. Four quarters we've been fighting for five games. So the advantage we got against them, they haven't fought yet. They haven't. They haven't fought for four quarters yet. They've been sitting on the sideline for two quarters, resting, while we still grinding and fighting, having fun. You understand what I'm saying? So all that stuff about they number one and all this, two in the nation, out the window at 11 o'clock, because I guarantee you I got y'all back. At any point, just ride with me. Ride with me, and I guarantee you, it's gonna be a fight.
Let's go.
That's all I gotta say, dog. It's been on my heart for 2 days. Just ride with me, dog. I got your back. Four quarters, and if it's overtime, we going overtime. And I guarantee you this: 11 brothers, we gonna fight all day. That's all I gotta say, bro.
Phil don't say much. off the field. You know, when he's on the field, he's talking a lot, you know, but just in a group, he don't say much. And for him to stand up and just, you know, pour out his heart, you know, you felt that. And he gave me chills, gave me goosebumps, you know, because it was like, that was a passionate, you know, expression of how he really felt, you know, and he got me fired up, and I felt where he was coming, and I was ready to go at war with him.
And it was just intense, man. I was ready to play. And I don't know, after speeches like that, it's hard, I feel like, for a person to not be ready to play. You know, it's just real motivational. And you just want to go out there and play, man. You just want to go out there and, it's bad to say, but hurt somebody's kids.
When Fia said that speech, I was just like, man, let's just go play. Nah, and I feel like I ain't never been that focused where I ain't laugh. Cause I be joking and stuff. I just can't never get serious. But when Fia said that speech, it just felt like I just wanted to go play. Like I just tuned in. I wasn't thinking about nothing. Like nothing, no stand, nobody in the stand, no nothing. I was just keying in on what I had to do. He got me crunk. Like that speech, that made me want to fight.
It just had been on my mind like the whole week. Cause it's like, when I first got here, it was like, for some reason, we couldn't get past what, I'm saying we now because I'm a part of it, but when I first got here, it was like they couldn't get past this one team. And I know where I'm from, it don't matter who you step in front of, who step in front of you, it don't matter what's in front of you. You know that you're going to beat this person, you're going to beat this obstacle that's in front of your face, no matter what it is. And I just never had that mindset was like, somebody can beat me or something that's put in front of my face, I can't not do or I cannot overcome this. And it just kept going on and on and on and on. The crew this, Marin Hardin-Baylor this. And I really got mad. And I was just speaking from the heart, and that's why I guess everybody said it really touched him or moved him, because it was coming from the heart. Like, I was really mad. Like, we shouldn't be feeling this way, or they shouldn't feel this way. We who we are. If you can't be who you are, then why are you in this game? This game is for the strong. And that's how I was just coming off the heart. And that's why I guess it moved a lot of people.
Upstairs, the LC coaches gathering for a time of prayer.
Gabriel Miller, he and his wife Samantha teach in the music department. He's a Florida guy, grew up in Florida, huge Florida State fan. So he and Coach Morrison, you know, they got a lot in common. But he just felt led and wanted to come pray for the coaches this week. And Gabe leads our music over at River Outreach Center, and I just told him, come on, pray for us, man. So pray for us, my brother.
Okay, I appreciate you, Pastor Dunn, for letting me do this. I know time is an issue, so I wrote it out so that I wouldn't waste any time with my words.
Thank you, Lord.
Dear Dad in heaven, first off this morning, we want to tell you that we love you, that we revere you, that we enjoy you. Thank you for everything. We know that everything we have comes from you, and we are grateful. Now, specifically this morning, Daddy God, I come to you as your child to ask for something from you. It's something that you have told us in your word to ask for, and so I come boldly to ask, not hesitantly. What I ask for this morning is wisdom. Not just everyday common sense, but biblical wisdom. Your wisdom. I pray that you would bestow your wisdom on this coaching staff today. With this wisdom, you will lead us down perfect paths to perfect destinations. Second, may we have faith. James 1 tells us of your plan to bestow wisdom on us according to our faith. It reads, but if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. This is my prayer for these coaches today. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Woo!
Thank
God.
Amen.
Thank God.
Thank you.
Downstairs, game time is closing in.
Thank you.
The final event of this pregame preparation, co-defensive coordinator Brian Wallace has had a motivational video put together.
Preface this video with this. You're gonna see some clips. This bout, Muhammad Ali's going for the title. His birth name is Cassius Clay. He's fighting Ernie Terrell. Ernie Terrell doesn't respect him. Cassius Clay's got to go take the title. Okay? Know that going into the thing.
Lord, I pray that this would not be the fire of a forest fire that just blows out of control. Lord, let it be the fire of a laser that can cut steel. And God, we'll give you the glory and honor and praise. We thank you that you've gone before us. The battle is yours. In Christ's name, amen. Let's go. Two by two, let's go. Ability. It's not about tradition. It's about one thing. Do you believe? That's what it boils down to. What's in your heart today? Cast out every seed of doubt, every seed of fear, and understand this. The Bible says that perfect love cast out all fear. And that's the greatest strength of this football team. It's our love one for another. You go out there and play by that guy next to you. And the way you love him is you get his back. In every way. Play every play the very best you can play, and then move to the next play. Don't think back, don't think ahead. Just the next play. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you that your word tells us that perfect love casts out all fear. And I thank you today we go in your strength. There's no pressure on us. We give this to you. This is your battle. God, give us great strength for 60 minutes, and we'll give you the glory. We promise we will. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. All right, captains, roll.
Let's go, man. Let's go, man.
Ahead, Louisiana College, you won the toss. Mr. Bowl. You want the ball? Let's go. We wanted it to do. Let's go. Louisiana College. Nope. Louisiana College has won the toss. We're receiving the north goal. Guys, come on in, shake hands. Let's have a good one.
Let's go, man.
Let's go.
Let's go. With all that buildup now behind them, the Wildcats meet their foes square in the face. LC's opening drive is short-lived, three and out, and now a test for the defense. Mary Hardin-Baylor's Ladero Bailey is as good a quarterback as there is in Division III and has been a thorn in LC's collective side for 3 years running. Making things even harder to defend, top running back Darius Wilson. The crew takes their first possession to the LC 31, but they get no further. Chad Peavy's 48-yard field goal sails wide left, and LC dodges an early bullet. The LC offense responds with its own drive into enemy territory. Jamie Bunting finding Kyle Gallion for 21 yards to the crew's 39. But any potential for scoring is dashed when Bunting is sacked by Silvio Diaz, and LC will punt it away.
What did 39 do? Did he stretch or he came inside?
He stunned it out and came back inside.
In the first quarter, neither team is able to establish a sustained drive, but the crew coming up with the big play here, Bailey finding Jeff Miles for the 32-yard completion down to the LC 28. But that drive will stall for Mary Hardin-Baylor when Phil Ford sacks Bailey. Peavy in again, this time missing from 42 yards out, and the game moves to the second quarter with still no score.
And put it in now.
As the first half grinds on, neither team able to gain an advantage. But midway through the second quarter, the LC offense seems to catch its stride, not with big plays, but chipping away.
Turn up, let's go!
when Bunting and Galleon connect for 21 yards here, LC finding itself with its best field position of the game so far, first down at the Crew 32-yard line. Two plays later, the two connect again, and Galleon down to the 9-yard line with a first down. With that combination working well, Bunting under pressure, looking for Galleon again. This time, Kyle can't hang on. Wildcats have to settle for the field goal instead. From 25 yards out, Adon Olivares' kick is good. LC striking first, leading 3-0. 2:18 left to go in the first half.
You have your hand?
Yeah, I mean, I go for it.
Okay, you got to have another shot, okay? You got to be ready for it. You make that play 9 out of 100, right? The one's gone. You got 99 left, all right?
After playing an incredible half of football, the LC defense does it one more time. Mary Hardin-Baylor's ensuing drive is a 3-and-out, the Wildcats forcing the punt with just under a minute left in the second quarter. And on the punt, an injection of energy when senior Pop Frederick returns at 33 yards to the LC 38. With 44 seconds left, the Wildcats sensing an opportunity to add to their slight lead. Bunting, with his confidence growing, looking for DeMario Parker. Two Mary Hardin-Baylor penalties will give the Wildcats a 1st and 10 at the Crew 15. But with time running out, Bunting nearly makes a huge mistake here, running instead of throwing it away, plus the fumble that's recovered by left tackle Jeremy Unovich, and the LC timeout comes with a 1/10 of a second left on the clock. While that final tick may have seemed like a huge break for the Wildcats at the time, it actually serves as a setup for disaster, with Olivares in to kick again. The Crew's All-American linebacker, Javis Jones, with the 95-yard touchdown with no time left on the clock, marking the worst possible scenario for LC to have experienced after a nearly flawless first half. Tempering it somewhat, Justin Williams blocking the extra point, but what should have been at least a 6-0 lead for LC at the half, turning instead into a 6-3 deficit, and more than that, will mark a devastating momentum shift in the football game.
And, you know, we just got to get over it. There are going to be momentum shifts in this game. We talked about it. I think we're in good shape. We just got to keep playing.
Job ain't done yet. Job ain't done yet. We only played 30 minutes. We got 30 more. Hey, answer that question. Answer that question. Answer their question. Leave no doubt. We're going out for 30 more minutes, man. If they don't score, they don't win the game. If they don't score, they don't win the game. Bottom line, period, enough said. Break it off for the coaches.
Yeah.
30 more minutes. Hey, they don't think you can hold the intensity for 60. They don't think you can play for 60.
All right, here we go. Let's go get loose.
Let's go.
All right, we shoot. No.
Father God, bless our worship in the second half. God, this is for you, in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Blood must be praised, man. Blood must be praised.
Let's go!
30 more minutes, fellas.
Despite the best efforts of the coaches to keep their players' minds in the right frame, there's little doubt that Jones's play has changed the complexion of the contest. And that fact will be underscored on the first play of the second half. Bailey hitting Miles 64 yards for the touchdown, and the air has left the balloon.
Bailey to Miles for the touchdown.
Whatever momentum the Wildcat offense had at the end of the half, that appears gone as well, as the LC drive goes 3-and-out. Everything the Wildcats defense did right in the first half, it can do no longer in the second. Bailey putting together another scoring drive, capping it with his touchdown pass to Elijah Hudson for 11 yards. And just like that, the Crew has grabbed control, leading 20-3.
Guess what? They
they score, that's over with, right? We always talk about recovery. Now's our time to recover. We can still get the ball. They're going to put it in the air. Every time they get up, they start passing the ball, right? So make sure we stay disciplined, stay calm out there, okay? This is all good, baby.
And Mary Hardin-Baylor not done there. Two possessions later, Bailey capping another scoring drive with the 16-yard pass to John Ross. The Wildcats seeing their hopes of an upset all but destroyed. And to make matters worse, potentially disastrous, on this play late in the third quarter, Ford, who had already had eight tackles in the game, hit by his own player Justin Williams while his arm is extended. Ford is down and will not return. Later diagnosed as a torn muscle, Ford in danger of missing the rest of the season.
That was the first time I ever cried on the football field, because I was mad, and it wasn't a point that I was hurt. It was a point that I couldn't go out there and finish what I started with my brothers. And till this day, I still can hear Dr. Brunet telling me that you're done. And it was like, I'm done. No, I can't be done. I'm not the type of person that's gonna be done. And it really like took a part of me when he said that.
Meanwhile, the crew defense making life miserable for the LC offense. A season low 300 yards for the Wildcats. Montague held to just 58 yards on 16 carries. Bunting 26 out of 46 for 258 yards, but two more interceptions. It marks the commitment to bunting for the rest of the season. Come good or not so good, on this day, not so good.
We just couldn't catch a groove, I guess. We've been having problems catching our rhythm all year, and we had it in the first half, and then for some reason we lost it in the second half.
To me, we two equally teamed, but playing that type of team is the team that make the less mistakes. And we wasn't that team today. We had a few mistakes, and it was just a battle. And once they got the momentum, it was just hard to get it back.
The Wildcats shut out in the second half, suffering their worst loss of the season, 30-3 the final score, as they fall to 4-2 and see their playoff hopes take a major hit as well.
Now, I love you. I'm proud of you. I'm proud of the way you fought for four quarters. And here's what I know about you. You're going to come back and fight next week. We're going to go out to Sol Ross, and we're going to get a victory, and we're going to get back on track to go to the playoffs. You still have all your goals at hand. Be the winningest team in the history of Louisiana College, make the playoffs. I'd like to see them again. I'm telling you, I'd really like to see them again. You understand? Let's pray, and let's take a good evening off, rest.
My answer right now to me, the way I'm feeling on the game, yeah, it's hurtful to lose. I done put it behind me already. You know what I'm saying? I'm looking forward to going to get started tomorrow. We're ready to face Sol Ross. We got to win 4 out to make the playoffs, as Coach told us. So, well, I feel like we got a good enough team to be in the top 10 in the nation right now. We just got to come out and show everybody else. Because right now, I know we ain't going to have too many believers. We done lost the two top 10 teams. And this one today just ain't help us, but we're going to go out and show the people what we can do these next four games.
Brothers,
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Brothers.
Secondary, right here.